Here's my mind map that I made when I watched it. And hopefully yours looks a little bit better than mine, but just some highlights that I noticed from that is one, just the scale of the system, 10,000 tons per day and 7,200 employees doing all that work. So if you think of all the systems that bring products into the world, storefronts to distribute them and door-to-door deliveries and all this stuff, all of that stuff generates waste and all that has to come back and go to the right place as well. So there's really a lot of machinery involved in moving all that material. And then there's also the very human side of it. So they talked about the workers and how they navigated the streets, and they talked about the families and learning how to divert waste and things like that. So there's a lot of complexity to waste systems, and they've evolved a lot over time, from just throwing it in the ocean, as we saw in the video, to now trying to work on getting more diversion, getting that closed loop of growing vegetables and bringing them back into the city. And the more diversion that they can achieve, then the less they'll be shipping out to other states to dispose, which is like a really wild conclusion that that's what they have to do. They just need to send it away to get rid of it. So there's a lot of work left to do in waste in New York City and in almost everywhere in the world. Everywhere in the world. So in that video, we saw kind of the full life cycle of waste and all the pieces of an integrated solid waste management system. So we saw waste generation, on-site handling, sortage, storage, and processing, and collection. So those first few things are kind of all the things we see as consumers or at a bigger scale in kind of commercial, institutional, industrial operations. And then sorting, processing, and transformation. So we saw some of the transfer stations, some of the MRFs, transfer and transport. So we saw the trucks that ship everything out of town, and there were some barges that they used earlier in time. And then finally disposal, which was at landfills out of state and incinerators out of state in the video. But all these kind of six things are parts of the whole system. And when we talk about making changes in the waste system, we actually change this whole life cycle at once. So if you can reduce the use for one for a product, it reduces the need to do all these things down the in the whole integrated system all the way down. So it has big effects what we do within the system. And the very end of that list is disposal. Now, disposal is something we want to avoid as successful solid waste engineers, but it's something that we haven't really been able to make a dent in yet. So over time, as you can see in the figure, we've been getting more and more diversion technologies. So we've been getting more recycling, more organic waste, using more energy recovery through incineration, but we keep consuming more and more too. So this big orange block in the middle has kind of stayed the same over time. Even though we have all these new technologies, we're still landfilling the same amount because we haven't addressed kind of those, the core issue of us making so much waste. So that's where the waste hierarchy comes in as a really useful topic to get us to really be thinking about not creating so much waste in the first place. So the waste hierarchy is an upside down triangle. The things at the top of the triangle are the things that we should be doing a lot of, and the things at the bottom are things that we should be doing very, very little of. So it's kind of like the food pyramid, eating more of the stuff at the big wide base of the triangle and less of the stuff at the very top of the triangle. So the very first thing at the top of the waste hierarchy is prevention. So are there things we can do that we don't need to create waste from this? This is the single most effective thing we can do to address waste, and it usually helps us save money and improve social outcomes as well. So it's a real no-brainer, but there's a lot of barriers to getting this prevention to happen, and we'll talk about that in the next unit quite a bit. The second one is preparing something for reuse. So it's kind of reduce, reuse, recycle. So the first one is reduce, second one is reuse. So what parts of the system can we use to put materials back into use within the system? So we're not preventing its use, but we're at least being able to use it again. And then recycling, instead of actually reusing something, we're going to reuse the materials, but we're going to make it into something new. So we have to put a little bit more effort into doing that. So it's less preferred. And then going down, we have other recovery, which really means energy recovery. So if we can't use the materials, can we squeeze some energy out of it somehow? And then finally, disposal. We've done everything we can. We've got something left. We have no use for it. How can we deal with that in a way that doesn't affect human health and the environment as much as it could? So as we go through the term, we're going to kind of cascade down this list. So chapter two, we're going to talk about waste minimization and waste diversion. So how can we kind of get stuff out of the waste system in the first place? Then we'll talk about organic waste, which has a recycling aspect in terms of recycling the nutrients, as well as an energy recovery aspect in terms of extracting some of the energy that's contained in organic materials. We'll talk about materials recovery, as in blue box waste and other ways to get recyclables out of waste streams, such as mixed waste processing, mechanical biological treatment, and even landfill mining. We'll talk about landfills themselves, which are a disposal site, but they also have energy recovery opportunities through the landfill gas. And then thermal treatment, which I'd consider a disposal site as well, but also it has energy recovery opportunities from burning those materials or treating them with pyrolysis or gasification to produce other fuels from them. So we'll kind of flow down the list. So the stuff we talk about at the beginning of the term is the most effective and the least engineering. And as we go through, we'll get less effective and add more engineering to it. So we'll keep talking about the waste hierarchy every day. Don't worry, it'll come back. So we looked at the waste hierarchy, which is a triangle. There's another couple of shapes that I want to talk about. So one is a line, and a line is the linear economy, which was something I talked about in the land acknowledgement videos, this way that we have in Canada and a lot of global north countries of having a take, make, waste system. So it's a one-way street. It harms the places we extract resources. It harms the places we put our waste at the end, and it's not sustainable. So the alternative to this line, which is a one-way street, which we're getting to the end of, is rolling it into a circle, which is the circular economy. And the circular economy is something that has been become a bit of a buzzword in Ontario. We have this strategy for a waste-free Ontario that talks about the circular economy, and we've got a bunch of new legislation that is pushing the circular economy. So one is the Resource Recovery and Circular Economy Act. I'm going to talk about this when we talk about regulations at the end of this chapter. But the whole idea of that circular economy is by following the rules in the waste hierarchy, which is the triangle, we end up actually making a circle where we're reusing our materials and our energy, and we're putting less into the system. So it's kind of a dream we're trying to get to. We have a long, long way to go, but there's a lot of good examples about how it's starting to work. So as solid waste engineers going into the field now, this is going to be the number one thing for us to work on.